House Committee on Tourism has proposed a 43 billion peso stimulus package to help the country's ailing tourism sector. With us now from Quezon City is Tourism Department Undersecretary Benito Bengzon to discuss the measure. Sir, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Vivian.
Yusek, before we discuss the stimulus package, let's first get an update on the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic to the local tourism so far. We know that it is one of the pillars of the economy, contributing 12.7% of the GDP last year and over 5 million jobs. How did revenues for the first 4 months of the year compare to our targets? And how many jobs in the sector have been affected?
Well, Vivian, we've only been able to track the figures for the first 3 months of 2020. And based on our initial estimates, foreign visitor arrivals to the Philippines decreased by about 35%. That's minus 35% January to March of this year compared to the same period in 2019. In terms of absolute figures, we're looking at approximately 1.4 million foreign visitors that entered the country. And the ironic thing about it, in a way, is that we were actually growing in January by 8%, but it was in February that I started to see the slide, and the decrease was even sharper in March. Now, in terms of revenue, we're basically looking at the same decrease, about -35%, -36% so far.
Mm-hmm. How about in terms of jobs? How many have been affected so far?
Well, right now we don't have the exact figures, but we estimate that easily one half of the 5.4 million workers in various tourism-related enterprises has been affected by the pandemic. But this is precisely what we're trying to work on now with the Tourism Response and Recovery Program, which Secretary Bernard Romulo Puyat has asked us to accelerate.
All right. Yusek, some lawmakers are proposing a 43 billion peso stimulus package for the tourism industry. Could you give us a breakdown on how it will be utilized?
Well, first, the 43 is still preliminary. It's not tentative. But we plan to address the major concerns that have been raised by the private sector. And in a series of consultations that we've had, they basically identified five major concerns. The first one is in terms of the need for working capital. The second one is in terms of repayment of loans, tax payments, disruption in the supply chain, and of course the safety and the health and safety of the workers. So we are zeroing in on the need for soft loans for working capitals of tourism enterprises. So out of the 43 billion, we estimate that about 36 billion will go to soft loans for working capital. We're setting aside about 4 billion for infrastructure to adapt to the new normals. This will take care of TIEZA, the Tourism Infrastructure Enterprise Zone Authority, because we feel that the new facility or the facilities post ECQ and post pandemic will have to be redesigned, repurposed to meet the changing needs of the consumers and the travelers. We're also setting aside a certain amount for capacity building and skills enhancement, and of course for marketing and market development.
Mm-hmm. So bulk of the funds will go to the soft loans. What or how can businesses avail of these soft loans, sir?
Well, we have yet to come up with the guidelines. I think the first step here is for Congress to pass the economic stimulus bill. But basically, we have an idea already of what types of loans or financial assistance the private sector will. So this is something that we'll have to flesh out once the bill is passed.
Mm-hmm. And what incentives for domestic tourism are we looking at?
Well, for domestic tourism, as we've mentioned, previously, we feel that this will really stimulate the demand for travel. Right now, what we're doing is the Department of Tourism has waived some of the fees that it normally collects from the private sector. We've issued a moratorium, for example, on the collection of accreditation fees. Eventually, when we start marketing promotions again overseas, we have actually waived the participation fees for all international pairs for the rest of 2020 and the whole of 2021. So these are just some of the measures that we have taken to assist our partners from the private sector.
Yusek, you also mentioned that 4 billion pesos will go to TIESA projects. What particular projects are these?
We have not yet identified the specific projects, but we've already come up with some general guidelines. Mm-hmm. So as I mentioned, the facilities in a post-ECQ period will have to adapt to the changing needs of the travelers. For example, you will probably have a bigger space for hand washing. You'll probably have sanitizer stations strategically located. Maybe some of the rest areas or restrooms will have to be reconfigured. So these are just some of the ideas that have been floated.
How about in terms of areas? Have we identified specific areas where these infrastructure will be placed?
Well, right now we're just guided by the priority areas, the priority tourism enterprise zones that have been identified by TIESA. But it is not limited to these areas, because what is important is for us to be able to, like I said, adapt to changing consumer behavior and expectations, and to make sure that the health protocols that we are practicing now will continue to be practiced in the future, and to make sure that the facilities will allow us to do so.
What is our target time frame for the implementation of the response and recovery plans for the tourism sector, sir?
In our tourism response and recovery program, we've basically broken down our action plan into three time frames. The first one is what we call the response period, where we are in right now. And we're looking at between now and the end of June, or maybe July, as the response period. And after that, we move to what we refer to as the recoil period, or the transition, where we will start our promotions and marketing in a little way. And then lastly would be the recovery period, which would be from 2021 and beyond. But I think what's important here is to highlight that in the response and recoil period, it's really essential for government agencies to provide the necessary support to our tourism stakeholders. We need to help them get back on their feet, because obviously the revenue stream has been disrupted over the last month and a half.
And the DOT also mentioned that it is eyeing domestic travel as one of the major revenue generators amid this COVID-19 pandemic. How do we plan to encourage domestic tourism?
Well, we will come up with, a campaign to assure travelers that it is safe to go around the planet. Based on our discussions with the private sector, we feel that domestic travelers will probably start with short distances. They will probably opt to go by land and travel with families in the meantime. They will also opt for more open air or outdoor kind of tourism experience. But eventually, we are confident that they will start to travel long distance and eventually start taking other modes of travel.
Are we also looking at lower hotel rates or airfares? Have we discussed this with stakeholders?
Well, of course, we've discussed ways and means of encouraging domestic travel. The value for money is still a motivation for many travelers, but in the post-pandemic or post-ECQ period, we feel that there will be other factors that travelers will be looking at. For example, they will be looking at flexibility in the travel arrangements. Will I be able to rebook or to refund the package in case the travel is canceled? They will also be looking at health insurance considerations. So the requirements will change in the near future. Obviously, there will still be a segment or some travelers who will be price driven, and it will be important for the hotels and the airlines to offer attractive rates to them.
And once the ECQ is lifted, how will we market the Philippines to foreign tourists who may have apprehensions to travel due to COVID-19?
Well, safety is of course a very important consideration. We have to assure our tourists that they'll be able to have a safe, secure, and enjoyable stay here in the country. We have to make sure that the health protocols, the hygiene practices that we've been practicing over the last couple of months will continue. We have to make sure also that they have information on nearest or the nearby medical facilities, just to give them some assurance. And of course, we'll have to continue to work on improving our tourism products so that they're distinct, they're compelling, and that they will differentiate us from what the other countries in ASEAN or Asia are offering.
And of course, once the ECQ is lifted, we will be looking at the new normal. How will this look like in the tourism sector?
We're looking at the new protocols, new procedures. For example, in tour groups, there's been some discussions already on whether we should just have a 50% capacity, for example, in a 50-seater bus. So if previously you would have 50 passengers, and maybe you would just limit it to 25 passengers. We're also looking at the mandatory distribution of face masks and sanitizers. We're looking at putting sanitizer stations in strategic locations. There will be probably a more preference for outdoor activities, the low density kind of tourism experience. So these are just some of the new protocols that we're looking at. Of course, for the hotels, they will have to come up with their own guidelines in a post-COVID, post-ECQ period. We're talking about maybe putting acrylic glasses in the front desk. They're also talking about reviewing the face spread, maybe the dining experience, the configuration of the dining areas might also change. So these are just examples of the new normals that are being discussed.
And by May 16th, we'll be seeing this, sir?
Well, we have yet to craft the guidelines. We're consulting the hotel owners. But eventually, the idea is to have this ready by this month.
Do we have a specific date for issuing the guidelines, sir?
Well, we're looking at around the middle of this month. Mm-hmm. For the finalization of the guidelines on health and safety and accommodation establishments. Mm-hmm.
And have we estimated how much is the cost implications of this new normal that we are advocating?
We have not yet come up with any estimates, but obviously this will increase the capital expenditures of the hotels and the other accommodation establishments. That's why we're also working with the concerned government agencies to provide some fiscal incentives for those who would be upgrading or reconfiguring their facilities to address the challenges of the current pandemic.
Finally, Yusek, you did mention that recovery period will be around 2021 and beyond, but when do we expect the tourism sector to fully get back on its feet and tourism revenues to return to at least 2019 levels?
Well, I'm with the Department of Tourism. I have to be very optimistic, and I'm hoping that we can recover by next year, but even the United Nations World Tourism Organization stated on a few occasions that it might take a good 2 to 3 years to bring tourism back to the levels that we enjoyed in 2019. Again, we're keeping our fingers crossed. We're hoping that the turnaround will be much earlier than that.
Thank you for accommodating our call, Yusek Benito Bengzon of the Philippine Department of Tourism.